Good morning and welcome to our service this morning from St Mary's in Eversley and St Barnabas in Derby Green. As we bring to a conclusion our series of looking at God's generosity, we give thanks today for his generous gift of grace and of love. And we ask the question of what our response is to him. As we begin our service and we lift God's name high in praise, let's pray together. Generous God, as we come to you today, we give you thanks for your grace and ask that we would know your Holy Spirit's presence near us this day and always. Amen. We begin our service by singing our first song, Lord, I lift your name on high. Come before God and enter into his presence, we recognize our dependence upon him and our need for his grace, for forgiveness for those times when we have sought our own ends and put ourselves first, for those times when we've not loved our neighbor as ourselves. And so we come to God in confession, praying for his help. When we have rejected your generous offer of love, which overwhelms us, Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Jesus, when we fail to praise you for the gift of your Spirit upon us, Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. When we fail to reflect your generosity in our own lives, Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. May the Lord enrich you with his grace and nourish you with his blessing. The Lord defend you in trouble and keep you from all evil. The Lord accept your prayers and absolve you from your offences. For the sake of Jesus Christ, our Saviour. Amen. a prayer for today. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the abundance of your love, for all that you give us through Jesus. May we show forth in our lives the generosity which flows to us from you. Make us warm-hearted and generous people. We ask this through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. We're now going to have our Bible readings read to us today by Charlotte from St. Mary's and by Sarah from St. Barnabas.
Today's reading is taken from Deuteronomy chapter 15, verses 7 to 15. If anyone is poor among your fellow Israelites in any of the towns of the land of the Lord your God is giving you, do not be hard-hearted or tight-fisted towards them. Rather, be open-handed and freely lend them whatever they need. Be careful not to harbour this wicked thought. The seventh year, the year for cancelling debts, is near, so that you do not show ill will toward the needy among your fellow Israelites, and give them nothing. They may then appeal to the Lord against you, and you will be found guilty of sin. Give generously to them as so without grudging heart. Then because of this, the Lord your God will bless you in all your work and in everything you put your hand to. There will always be poor people in the land. Therefore, I command you to be open-handed toward your fellow Israelites who are poor and needy in your land. Freeing servants. If any of your people, Hebrew men or women, sell themselves to you and serve you 6 years, in the seventh year you must let them go free. And when you release them, do not send them away empty-handed. Supply them liberally from your flock, your threshing floor and winepress. Give to them as the Lord your God has blessed you. Remember that you were slaves in Egypt and the Lord your God redeemed you. That is why I give you this command today.
Good morning, everybody. Today's reading is from Luke chapter 21, verses 1 through 4. As he looked up, Jesus saw the rich putting their gifts into the temple treasury. He also saw a poor widow put in two very small copper coins. "I tell you the truth," he said, "this poor widow has put in more than all the others. All these people gave their gifts out of their wealth, but she, out of her poverty, put in all she had to live on."
We're now going to have our talk, which is by Jane Hughes from St. Mary's today.
Hello. Today we're continuing with our story of Generous June. And today's story is from Luke's Gospel, The Widow's Mite, something I'm sure you, like me, have heard before. But let's just look at it and see if we can take something from it today for us. So, we've seen lots of generosity in these last few months when things have not been as they normally were. We've seen the generosity of doctors and nurses and other key workers, friends and relatives helping us, helping others. People being generous with their time, with their skills, their talents, their money, helping to keep things going. Now in this passage, we see a widow generously giving to the church. But we also see a widow who had been in a position really to need help to receive. As a widow, she would have lived outside the normal social structure, where every woman lived under the authority of a man. Therefore, the widow was responsible to and for herself. The widow's husband's family may have refused to take her under their wing, and she was therefore left in a very precarious position, susceptible to oppression, injustice, and exploitation with no male protector. So here was a widow who would be in need, but she deprived herself and gave to others, putting her trust and dependence on God. As Jesus watches her, I don't think he's being judgmental. He doesn't condemn those who who give out of their plenty. He just draws the disciples' attention to the fact the widow gave more, because she gave her all. The widow knew what sacrifices she would have to make because of her sacrificial giving. It wasn't giving from her excess, like the rich men who went before her in the temple. No, her giving was sacrificial and generous. The widow didn't depend on her money, but she depended on God. She was defined by her relationship with God. Now I'm going to read you those few verses again now from the Message version of the Bible. Just then, Jesus looked up, and he saw rich people dropping offerings in the collection plate. Then he saw a poor widow put in 2 pennies. He said, "The plain truth is that this widow has given by far the largest offering today. All these others made offerings that they'll never miss. She gave extravagantly what she couldn't afford. She gave her all. She gave her all." What does this mean? And what does it mean for us? I think it means what it says on the tin: our all, our lives, our heart. Jesus can see how much we give, but his interest isn't in the amount we give, but our motives, our faith, what's in our hearts. How does God, who knows our heart, look at us and our efforts? He looks at our generosity, what's in and on our hearts. He calls us all to be part of the body of Christ, to support each other, to face the needs of others and deprive ourselves, to be generous givers. We give out of who we see ourselves to be in Christ. We should give from our heart out of thanks and love to God. So in 2 Corinthians 9 it says, "Each of you must give as you have made up your mind, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver." And giving, it has been shown in a study at the University of Zurich, makes us happy. There's a neural link they've discovered between generosity and happiness. So the more generous you are, the happier you are. That's great, isn't it? So really, we shouldn't be putting our hope and our joy and our trust in our money. Instead, we should put our hope and joy and trust in God. That's in Matthew 6, starting at verse 19. "Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust consume and where thieves break in. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust consume, and where thieves do not break in. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." So let's just spend a moment picturing ourselves in God's hand, putting our trust in Him. Jesus isn't interested in the amount we put into the collection bag each week or donate through the parish giving scheme. No, he's interested in our heart, our faith, our relationship with him. Now, I don't believe that in this passage Jesus is saying we should give away all our money, as that would just lead to an increase in the poor who need supporting. Instead, I think he's saying we need to put ourselves wholly and completely in God's hands, to put our trust in Him and rely on Him. As what we give is an indication of our priorities, What we spend our money on indicates where our heart is. So let us reflect on how we're going to respond. What will our generous giving look like? Will it consist of time, skills, and money? I'll leave you to think over that in this coming few days. What will our generous giving look like? Will it consist of time, skills, and money? So let's finish with a prayer. Loving God, we see your image generously reflected in the face of your Son, Jesus Christ, and we receive the gift of your generous spirit within us. Help us to reflect your blessings of life, generous in thought and word and deed, today and throughout our lives. Amen.
We're going to continue to think about God's goodness to us in this song. It's probably a new song to many of us, but it talks about the story we've heard today and about our response to God's grace.
To ask of Christ, good teacher, will you tell me what must I do for eternal life? I've kept your laws completely. Sell all you have, give to the poor, then heaven's treasures shall be yours. How hard for those who are rich on earth to gain the wealth of heaven. Jesus sat by the offering gate as people brought their money. The rich, they filled the collection plate. The widow gave a penny. Now she's outgiven all the rest. Her gift was all that she possessed. Not what you give, but what you keep is what the king is counting.
We're now going to have our prayers of intercession led by Richard Ranson from St. Barnabas Church.
Dear Lord, we thank you for the church of which we are members and for the Holy Spirit at work amongst us all. Be with those who lead us in our worship of you. We pray your blessing on all who share with us this church's life, that we may all grow in knowledge of your love. We pray that as a congregation, we may be aware of the needs of others. Help us as children of your family to respond to them by our understanding, by our support, and by the love we show them. Father, we pray that your church throughout the world, that it may share to the full in the work of your Son, revealing you to all and reconciling them to you and to one another. We pray that Christians may love one another and their neighbours as you loved us, and that working together they may bring peace to all people. Lord, you are head of the church, and we are reconciled by you by Christ's death and resurrection. As the global church, we have a message of hope that we can share far and wide, no matter what else is happening in our world. Whilst we have been worshipping you remotely during lockdown, we pray that churches will be united again once more and the doors open wide to worship you in your holy place. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Creator God, we praise you for your provision of this beautiful planet. Help us to listen, learn, and seek you in all we do, for we desire to steward your gifts well. Father, in this insane world, you have a good plan for us. Help us to remain calm on days that don't line up with our plans. Forgive us, for we fail so often to submit them to you and run great risk with the following ways of the world. Lord, as humans, we can sometimes forget that you ultimately created the world and are not absent from it, but all-powerful in it. We are called to pray for others in our world facing challenges and difficult situations. This day we lift you to you, the people of the world, reeling from COVID-19, the loss of lives and jobs on a global scale, and the worry and uncertain times ahead. May your healing spirit and loving arms give us peace and trust in you during the days to come. And God, we pray for all those who suffered in this world from disease and malnutrition. Soothe the cries of those suffering and heal your dear children. God, we ask that you be with those who have no place to call home. We ask that all you will be with all immigrants and refugees who suffer and live in fear. And we pray that your loving presence may always be with your children who cry out in fear of not knowing what may happen to them next. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, we pray for our neighbourhood, our local community, to embody friendships, kindness and compassion. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for where you have placed us at this time. Where we live is no accident. This neighbourhood is our mission field, and we declare that Satan has no power here. Neighbour will embrace neighbour, and the strong will stand for the weak. The young will respect the old, and the capable will assist the unable. These homes will be safe havens of friendship, kindness and compassion. No one will go hungry or unnoticed. Lives here will be changed. Lord, we pray for our schools to be a hub where the character of Jesus is on display to faculty and students. Holy Spirit, break down the barriers that divide and isolate our students. Unite administration and faculty. Stand guard at the doors and blow through the halls. Be the friendship and acceptance that every student longs for. Be the firm yet loving authority every teacher needs. Our classrooms belong to you, even if the classroom is now our homes. Father, raise up God-fearing men and women to serve in state and local government. We ask for your presence in the streets and homes of our community. We pray for local law enforcement, for their safety and wisdom and compassion in all circumstances. We pray your comfort for those who have experienced violence, and we ask your protection for all our neighbours. And dear God, we pray different cultures will be able to understand and care for one another in our community. We pray that the diversity of your people will be celebrated by all, just as you affirm and love each one of us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of compassion, despite our hopes and efforts, Lord, we fail and things go wrong. We pray for people who are suffering either from their own mistakes or from the mistakes of others. Heavenly Father, we pray for our own families and those we know, for children growing up within them, those enjoying a break away from school, those awaiting the results of examinations, those about to begin new lives away from home. Bless each and every one, and may they all know your presence and feel your guidance in their lives as they face new demands and challenges. We pray for those in need within our families, for those who are ill, whether in their homes or in hospital at this time. Bless them. May they know your love, and in doing so, receive courage and strength in the time of need. We pray for the elderly, especially those unable to leave their homes due to shielding. We pray for the lonely, especially those separated from loved ones at this time. We pray for those who mourn because of the death of loved ones, and for those who still miss the companionship and care of those dear to them. We hold them before you, Lord, for your healing love. We name them in our hearts and raise them to you, Lord. In particular, we think of those that are on our minds and in our hearts. Let us take a moment to pray silently for them. Finally, Lord, help us to keep our eyes on you so that we can follow your promptings and respond to your call. Help us to see when another soul around us needs to be encouraged. Help us to be faithful to carry one another's burdens, remembering that we are all in this life together. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Saviour. Amen.
Thank you for joining us for our service of worship today. Just a few things from me before we close with our final hymn of praise. Firstly, just to say you may have seen the notice during the week from the government about churches reopening. We're still processing all the information about that and waiting for some guidance. So please bear with us and we will let you know as and when our churches' buildings will be reopening for more than private prayer. Just a reminder, they are open for private prayer on Saturdays at St Barnabas from 10:30 till 12, and again on Mondays at St Mary's from 10:30 till 12. Please do join us for coffee after the service this morning on Zoom, the details in the newsletter. And again, please do join us this afternoon at 4:30. Whatever age you may be, please join us for a crafty act of worship as we have our messy church today. We close with our final hymn this morning.
Oh, May the Lord
bless you and keep you. May he make his face to shine upon you and give you his peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. As we begin our worship this morning, let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we come to you today, we thank you for your generous gift of grace and love to us. And as we lift your name high in praise, we offer ourselves to you afresh, asking for your help.